and then it was about lockdown. So when you say match preparation and why it is so important, the most important thing that comes to my mind is that most of the athletes perform, or you know, teams really play well in their practice matches. But when it comes to matches, actual competitive matches, you can see a drastic change in their performance. Now, why is this peculiar thing happening? What is the most crucial element which makes this difference? And how mental training can make a difference is something that I am going to throw a small light upon. So as I said, that one of the most important things is to understand that mind has an important role to play in performance. So when I speak to most of my clients, I always tell them that, you know, it's not just your physical fitness that matters. It's not just how well you know the technique and how well you're able to, you know, put it on the ground. It is about how well you're able to think and decide and execute all those that you know. That is the tactical part. Next is the psychological, the mental preparation that is required for all those situations, unpredictable, uncertain situations that can come on the field. Next is diet and nutrition. I have a fantastic physique, but if I'm not keeping it fueled to the right extent, I may not be able to play well. Yes, so diet and nutrition. And last is rest and recovery. I've been working hard as an athlete, day in, day out, and this is not what my body was made for. So if my body has to perform to the next level, it has to train harder with, you know, passing time. And so my recovery is also equally important. So all my dear coaches, parents, players, all these six elements make up to your peak performance. So you cannot rely on only one. And that's why sports scientists, together with coaches, parents, are helping clients or helping students, players, give their best performances. Together, when I say, even in individual sports, we say that even if you're playing an individual sport, all these components, all these people are important. And you are playing an group event, which all the more makes it interesting, as well as, you know, there are different challenges that football as a game has, mental challenges. So when I say what is the most crucial element in, you know, match preparation, for me, the most crucial element is my athletes, my team, and not just my team, but my team's coach, manager, and people who are in my support system all need to know about performance anxiety. One of the most important things that we all sports psychologists you know is that most of our referral cases come to us because of performance anxiety. Bachcha khelta to bahut acha hai match mein, practice mein, lekin match mein waisa nahi khel pata, you know. Then there are issues which develop within the team. There are communication issues within the team, with the coaches, and the individual starts losing his or her confidence. A lot of issues start building up. Now, why does all these things happen? It's because of the performance anxiety. Now, performance anxiety is very, very different for different individuals. So anxiety symptoms for one player may be something like feeling, you know, trembling in their hands or legs. For someone, it could be dizziness. For me, it used to be a frequent urination. For someone else, it is twitching. For someone else, it is, you know, breathing difficulty. So you never know, you know, these are the signals the body is giving us, but we are not looking into all these things. And as coaches, as you know, parents, or as players, it is important to understand what changes between your practice and match. Yeah, so for me, match preparation is about, you know, following a routine, understanding the unpredictable things and the anxiety, the changes that happen in my body. So simply, why anxiety has an impact on performance? Yeah, what is the link? How can a person or a team member who feels anxiety has an impact on his or her performance? So there are different kind of physiological changes that take place because of anxiety. So, you know, the alarm that you feel that this is a danger, leading to increase in your heart rate, your digestion, you know, getting affected. It's kind of put on hold. You feel trembling in your hands, legs, heaviness of your body. Your bladder is relaxed, so you may feel the frequent urination sensation. Your muscles are tensed, you're breathing faster, and all these things is making you way different than what you are as a player on field during your practice. So if you're not the individual that you play in practice, how would you expect to be the player on field during the match like you are in your practice sessions? This is the most important thing that I highlight upon with all my clients. What you see outside and what you see inside, or what you cannot see, is the two different part of you know, the stories. People can see the performance of an individual or a team, the body, the errors, the improvements, the behaviors, actions, mistakes, everything. But inside that individual is a very different story of a lot of thoughts, a rush of emotions, increased heart rate, leading to you know, faster and shallower breathing. Because the blood is you know, rushing towards the heart, you can feel the muscle tension. The body is stiff. The movements are restricted. There are errors happening, which usually don't happen. And these errors lead to performance issues, that is bad performance. So people are just looking at the performance element, but there's n number of steps that happen within a player, and that's what we are speaking about in our pre-match or match preparation. If we understand that there are these two different type of stories, and then we start working on the story inside us. So when I say football is a team event, I always try to understand that, you know, you as an individual have your own personality and your team has a personality. Yes. So your symptoms and the team's, you know, motto or the environment of the team might be very, very different. So every individual who is a part of the team also has to work on himself or herself and as a team. So there are two challenges here in team sports: working on self, and second is being able to contribute best to the team. So mental training for sure helps elevate anxiety, but this doesn't happen overnight. Okay, a lot of times the when clients come to us, or when teams or players or coaches discuss issues with sports psychologists, they speak about choking under pressure. They speak that players are not able to perform to their potential when it matters. Use of mental training helps them understand the science between mind and body, and by training on those mental tools and skills and using it on a regular basis, the first step is getting the performance to a so-so level. That means you're at least being better than what you were earlier. Slowly, with practice and precise practice, mental training helps the performance reach a good performance level. And then the last and the most awaited for every one of us is a flow performance, where there's beautiful coordination, where there's a sync of mind and body among different players, and you can see a wonderful execution of skills. So mental training also goes in stages. A lot of people expect that, you know, mental training is kind of a miracle which is to be adopted few weeks before competition, which is one of the most important myths which has to be broken. If I tell my players that don't train the entire year, but you can just start your training 15 or 20 days prior to your competition, you wouldn't agree, because you know the importance of practice, which helps you perform your skills to the best. Similarly, mental training also needs its time and practice to make sure you move from choking under pressure to flow performance. Then, I have so many things to talk about, and I know Konashki also is going to speak about it, but I am going to speak only about one most important thing that I, over 12 years of my practice, have noticed. So I'm going to share a very personal incident. I used to be very, very focused athlete. Yeah, in practice, superbly focused, and in competition, more focused. But focused on what? focused on my opponent, opponent's preparation, opponent's coach, opponent's equipments, opponent's foreign training, opponent's changes in their strategies. So extremely focused, but focused on wrong things. It did make a lot of difference in my performance and my career because focus mattered a lot. So like, I think one of the most important things of match preparation is what you focus on. If you're focusing on things which are beyond your control or which you cannot do anything about, this is one of the biggest mistakes that athletes do. There are some things that you can influence and there are certain things that you can control. It's about where you focus on. Are you focusing on things that you can control? What is it that you can control? Reaching the venue, doing your warm-ups, focusing on your strengths, working on your strategies, knowing your opponents, working your way of how to make sure that you'll pep yourself up in the play. These are factors within your control. So are you really focusing on factors within your control? Or like me, are you focusing on who is your opponent? How did they play the last match? Who is their star player? What is their strength? So you may be focused, but on wrong things. And this is what matters the most. During the match preparation or match time, what you focus on is very important. I'll give you an example. I have a battery, mobile battery. And I exhaust it by using multiple apps together. I'm thinking about a lot of things. I'm doing a lot of things. The battery will exhaust faster. Similarly, during a match or during competitions, our mental energy battery also gets exhausted when we think a lot about multiple things and factors beyond control. The performance that players give on field is only executed by the body, but the instructions or the commands are given by the brain. So the mental energy is extremely important for executing peak performance or good performance on field. If this mental energy is exhausted on unnecessary things, I'm sure your skills at which you are good at, you'll have very less energy to use them on field. That's why I always speak about factors within control and beyond control. So I'm a applied sports psychologist. When it's about applying sports psychology on field, you don't have time to think a lot, and you have to know how quickly you will be able to use certain things. So when I say you have to focus right, what exactly I mean by focus right? I need to know what I want to focus on. So factors within control and beyond control helps you have more control over your match preparation or your life in general. There are two types of factors. One are factors within control and one are factors beyond control. Those factors which you can manipulate, change, bring about a change in are called as factors within control. But those factors on which you cannot make any change is called as factors beyond control. It's the part of mental training where the coach and the players during their training sessions work on bringing the focus from factors beyond control to within control. Let me tell you, to get this factor within control focus in match, you have to bring this in your training circuit. The more you get this focus in your training, this would become automatic in your match performance. So match preparation is a routine which is actually executed already in your training scenarios. You are not doing anything new. You are doing everything that you have done in your training to train your mind. Your mind or your brain is a muscle which also requires training. So you have trained your mind in the training, and that trained mind helps you focus on factors within control in competition. So I'm not going to take too much time. I'll speak about one aspect, and that was focus. What you focus on makes a major difference. And that's why I feel, start working on what you as an athlete, what you as a coach, your students are focusing on, and what you are focusing on. Managers, parents, everyone has to understand. that all of us are a part of ecosystem which helps a performance get executed. So if a rule is being set for a player, it is also for the coach, manager, and the support system. So everyone needs to work on factors within control, because in the crucial moments, when you will focus on factors within control, a lot of things are going to change. How? I'm going to explain in the next part of the presentation. Okay, coming to the next topic, which is what ma'am had said about, you know, mental training in lockdown, or how to handle mind, how to handle yourself during lockdown. One of the most important things that is closely, affected in this corona system or corona lockdown is that our physical activity has been affected. We as athletes, coaches, parents are used to physical activity day in, day out. We know it has an amazing impact on our mood, our stress, our anxiety. And not just that, every day you are fueling yourself with self-esteem, you're feeling confident, you're achieving something new. And that's a drive which is keeping you running. Now that we are into these four walls and all these things are lacking, this is the lack of physical activity is having an impact on our mental health. So during lockdown, there are n number of changes that players, coaches, parents have been observing in the body, sleep pattern, weight, mood, and thoughts. Yes. Now this is where physical activity and the mental health is connected. But in spite of this, I'm sure most of our players are doing morning and evening training with their physical trainers, with their coaches, watching different kind of skills. In every possible way, they're trying to keep their body fit. But how about the mind? Are we really working on the mental fitness side? Not really. Why so? Because if there's an injury or if there's a concern to the body, I may take quick action. Because jo dikhta hai, uske upar hum zyada bharosa karte hain. But something that is not seen is not given its due recognition. Mental health is affected because it is not seen in the way we are used to seeing it. Dikhta hai, lekin aapne us nazariye se dekha nahi hai. I'm going to tell you what exactly we are speaking about changes in mental health status because of lockdown. We as players and individuals cannot work as a switch on off button. Something that happens in your personalized life affects you as a player. Something that affects you as a player affects your personal life. Yeah. So mental health is nothing but your emotional and psychological social well-being. Human beings are social beings. So it is very important for us to, you know, be social, meet people, interact. And this is what is not happening. We may say that we are connected to people over, say, Zoom or different platforms, but that actual interaction is lacking. Mental health is a lot, it affects a lot how we think, feel, and act. It not just helps us, in our life amazingly, it helps us handle stress. It affects how we handle stress, how we relate to other people in society, and what choices we make. So, right now, most of the webinars or sessions that I'm having is focusing on players' mental health. But a player is a part of an ecosystem where currently he is with his parents. Yeah. So the family mental health also has an impact on the player. So what do you mean by mental health? Or I would rather say, let's first understand what is a positive mental health. When we say positive mental health, that means an individual is able to realize his or her potential, is able to take care of the stresses. Everyone has stresses and is able to handle them to quite a good extent, work productively, and be connected, contribute to the best of his or her capacity. But like physical, when you have a physical illness, there are certain signs that the body shows which help you take a decision whether you're feeling ill or whether you need to call up a doctor, meet up a doctor, take an appointment or take the treatment. With respect to mental health, this has been one of the most neglected part. Most of the people don't know how to identify the early signs of, you know, challenges in mental health. So probably an erratic change in eating or sleeping pattern, not feeling like interacting with anyone, having excessive fatigue, having body aches unexplained, feelings of hopelessness or helplessness where you feel that, you know, you are not able to, you don't feel this is going to end, you know, being quite confused or being, you know, too emotional, always on an, you know, emotional ride. Yelling and fighting with family, friends, overreacting, severe mood swings, and, you know, memories of those past experiences which you cannot do anything about but still keep on recalling. Thinking of harming yourself or others, and simply not being able to do simple tasks like getting up, getting freshened up, eating your food, you know, your personal hygiene. You're not able to do the simple things. These are all signs that your mental health is affected. Now, I'm speaking about mental health because players' physical health is very important for his or her performance. Equally is his or her mental health. Mental health is not given much, you know, importance is because we are generally not looking for these signs. Mujhe khasi aa gaya, I'm calling an MD, not even an MBBS doctor. I just call up an MD, I ask for appointment, I take an appointment, I go, I meet for the silliest thing. But how many of them can say that they call up a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a counselor if they have experienced any of these symptoms? Players are assumed to be mentally tough. Because they are physically tough does not mean that their mental toughness will be the same. They might have issues at different level. And when I say issues, I'm going to explain you what. Let me take you through the challenges that come and then I'm going to explain you what exactly I mean to say by changes in a person's mind-body connection. But here I want to say, you are powerful. You are the one who will have to realize the changes in yourself. If you are a parent, it is important to understand the changes in yourself or your child and make sure you take the required action. It's important to use our innate power to understand that, yes, we are feeling a little different. Now, what is this feeling different? I'm going to explain. Now, what has been the biggest challenge in lockdown? The biggest challenge in lockdown has been stress. Stress? I mean, you have ample of time. Then what's stress about? Finances? How to spend time? What to do? When is this going to open up? Will I have my tournaments on time? Will I lose my fitness? What? What is it? What is causing stress? So basically, stress is an imbalance between your resources and demands. You want yourself to have certain things, and in this lockdown, you aren't being able to have those. Or you doubt that you may have, you may not be able to get what you want. Now, this simple thing is causing stress, and it is affecting not just your mind, but n number of different things. So maybe, you know, body, your emotions and your behavior. So simply, feeling restless, being attached to the screen for hours, getting up late, not having a schedule, sleeping late night, getting up late mornings. These are somewhere looked upon as only changes in behavior, but the process starts with something way before, which I will say as stress. So my simple funda for all my students is understand your mind and body connection. Ab sabke ghar mein TV hai, sabko TV dekhna hai. Everyone wants the remote control in their hand. Jiske haath mein remote hoga, who is the king of the house. तो जो चैनल उसे चाहिए वो चाहिए लगता है. सो लाइक टीवी इज बीन कंट्रोल्ड बाय रिमोट एंड रिमोट हैज दिस टू स्मॉल सेल्स विद इन इट. दिस सेम कॉन्सेप्ट लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड हाउ माइंड एंड बॉडी आर कनेक्टेड. लाइक एवरी वन कैन सी टीवी, एवरी वन कैन सी योर बॉडी एंड योर परफॉर्मेंस, बट योर बॉडी एंड परफॉर्मेंस इज बीन कंट्रोल्ड बाय सम रिमोट कंट्रोल विद इन यू विच इज कॉल्ड एज योर फीलिंग्स एंड इमोशंस. When your feelings and emotions change, it has an impact on your body and performance. And body and the emotions have their roots in nothing but your thoughts. Now, since I'm a cognitive therapist, I generally focus more on the thoughts which create emotions, which create, performance challenges. So when I said stress, is stress an emotion? Or a cognitive thought process. What do you think? Can someone write in the chat box? Or someone? Can someone tell? Just unmute yourself and tell. What is stress? Yeah. Yes. Kashvi. Yeah. She has raised her hand. So, is it an emotion or is it a thought? I am not able to hear you, Anjali ma'am. You have to unmute yourself.
Kashvi, just write it in the chat.
Yeah.
What do you think the answer is? We've got one answer from Siddesh who says it's a thought.
Okay. Yes. Anyone else?
Mukesh says stress is a thought.
Okay. Perfect. Okay. So I'll move ahead. So, a lot of people misinterpret stress as an emotion. But if you understand the definition of stress, it says it's an imbalance between what you want and what you have. So it's all within your cognitions or with what you're thinking about. So as they have rightly said, it is more of a thought rather than an emotion. And that is why if you can change your thought, you can change the emotions and emotion. And if you can change the emotion, it can change the body or the changes that we have just spoken about. Yes. So if we can change the way we think, we can change everything, the way we feel and way we behave also. So classically, if we want to change anything in our performance and body, we have to go back and check our thoughts, emotions and performance link, mind body connection. When I have positive thoughts, I feel positive, my body is reacting differently. In reversely, when I have negative thoughts, it affects my emotions like anger, irritation, guilt, say frustration, depression, all these, scales of emotions that you can have affect your performance. Now, in this lockdown, general psychology as a field has been focusing, or traditional psychology focuses on a lot of eradication of problems. But it's high time we have to understand that the current situation is helping us push us beyond our comfort and wanting us to look at what we have rather than what we don't have. So connecting it to what I said, focus. What do you focus on? Are you focusing on your problems or are you focusing on what you have at this point in time? There are n number of people who don't have basic food or shelter, or probably they don't have the basic amenities. We all have it, but our challenges are different. It's time in this lockdown to not just work on your body, but also on your mind. When I say let's work on the emotional refueling of ourselves, I say that I can work on the emotions of gratitude, hope, optimism, which will help me focus on what I have than what I don't have. Feel the drive to wait for that light at the end of the tunnel and not look at how long or how dark the tunnel is, and keep moving ahead in spite of all the challenges that are coming in. So this is simply, I'm going to pass this PPT to everyone so you can have the simple journal of how you can make sure that you observe gratitude in this lockdown. There are n number of things that mental training will tell you can do. But one of the most important thing is the emotional balance that you have to, achieve. Only then you can move from suffering to flourishing. Are you wanting to be in the suffering zone, the thriving zone, or you want to be in the flourishing zone where you really can use your strengths to be at your best? So positive psychology, which is a field, a subfield of psychology, speaks about, you know, the aspects that can bring more focus on positive elements than just working on the negative aspects. So how to create positive emotions? What kind of engagements can help you stay positive? Positive relationships, finding meaning and accomplishments are something that will help us, you know, stay more grounded, stay more aware about what's going inside us than outside. So we have to move a lot of mental mountains. And I feel that the challenges that COVID-19 has brought us to experience is way different than what we have ever thought. We never anticipated something like this could happen. So I just want to say, if you cannot go outside, how about going inside? How about working on your mind-body connection? How about realizing what are your thoughts, how they affect your emotions, and how they affect your performance and your behavior in general? So this is a small presentation that I wanted to make. There's so many things that we can talk about, but this was something that I wanted to share with everyone. And I know that, we have another talented speaker with us, a young footballer. So she will be able to speak more about the clinical side. She's a clinical psychologist, so clinical side plus being a footballer, she'll be able to connect well, use the mental training techniques and give examples. So I have kept it simple and to the core. Yeah, so thank you so much for giving me this opportunity, and I think I'm going to answer the questions at the end after I think Kunashni will complete her presentation.
Thank you so much, Amrita. That was very, very, very enlightening. And I can tell from, I always knew you were a great psychologist. And now I know, because you've also been a high level athlete yourself, that whatever you say is from pure experience also. I am sure all the speakers, all the listeners have loads of questions for you. So everyone who has a question, please just keep the question ready. We will be taking questions for Amrita after we see Kunashni's presentation.
Yes.
Can you please stop the screen share, Amrita, please?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. Now we are over to Kunashni. Kunashni, the first question I'm going to begin asking you is, how are you, Kunashni?
I'm doing well. Thank you, Anjali ma'am. Yes.
Okay, you can start your presentation from there, Kunashni. That's the first question a coach asks a player when he goes onto the field. How are you? And I think that has a... what do you think about that as a question a coach asks a player?
I think it's important for the coach to know how their players are doing right before the match. They might say that, you know, everything's fine, but then you go out there on the field and then the player just stops working, freezes, and you're like, what happened, you know? So, it is important to check how they're doing right before the match starts. But there's not much you can do at that point. So, by asking them how you feel, you should also say, just forget everything and just go for it. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Let's get started with your presentation, Kunashni. You have been a part of the Indian national team, and now you are into clinical psychology. Please let us know how you can put both these experiences together.
Yeah, yes. Just going to share my screen.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. Great. Okay, hi everyone. I'm Kunashni. And today we'll be talking about two things. One is dealing with the lockdown. And two is match preparation. So we're going to talk about sports psychology and psychology in general. And we're going to focus on what you can do with your mental game right now while you're at home, and what you can do, work on and prepare yourself for when you get back out there on the field. So let us begin. So today, just a general, how do I get rid of this? Okay. All right, so just a general overview of what we're going to talk about today. Why do we give importance to sports psychology? What is it? Then we'll talk a little bit about the lockdown and how we can prepare ourselves during this time. Then we'll talk a little bit about a few facts about how women's psychology is in sports, in football. Then we'll talk a little about match preparation and two techniques that we can use, goal setting and visualization. Okay, so this is a little bit about myself. So I started my journey, actually, my first national was when I was playing for PIFA. So with Anjali ma'am and Nirvan sir, you know, he was the coach and she was our manager. And we went to Chennai in Tamil Nadu for our first ever national. And it was an amazing experience. And that's when I got my first taste of what it's like to actually be out there on a full field and play with a different state. And I'm so in my presentation, I'm going to talk to you about psychology and I'm going to try and, you know, intertwine it with experiences that I've had on the field about match situations, being in the goal. So I've been a goalkeeper and how I used psychology at that point of time or what I thought about what I did. And we'll see how that goes. And you guys can ask questions at any point or at the end as well. So about myself, I played for Maharashtra. I also played for India in the under 16 level as the goalkeeper and vice captain. During my experience at the India camps, it was an amazing sporting and cultural experience getting to meet girls from all different parts of the countries. A lot of testing yourself in terms of your mental stamina, your resilience. I was the only girl from Maharashtra there at that point of time. I also had a major injury. I fractured my nose, had to get dropped from the team, had to leave and had to make my way back to the sport. So a lot there. And later when I pursued my education and I fell in love with psychology, I studied neuroscience, I studied the brain, how it works, how we process information, how we think. And then I decided to marry sports with psychology, especially with football, and come out here as a sports psychologist and talk to you guys and share with you all that we're going to talk about today. And a huge important topic is the need for mental training in Indian athletes because sports psychology or psychology in general is not given much focus. As Amrita ma'am talked about, mental health is such an important thing. And, you know, because we can't see it, we don't talk about it. Like she said, you know, if we have a cough, we call an MD, not even MBBS. But, you know, if we have stress or something going on, we just ignore it, suppress it, and we don't talk about our feelings and talk about things that are bothering us. And then that builds up over time and causes issues on the field. So this is super important, especially in India. I personally, myself, have never had a sports psychologist except during the PIFA carnival with Amrita ma'am. That was the only time I was exposed to a sports psychologist, 2011, 9 years ago. And after that, in all our matches, everywhere, nowhere. So this is need of the hour today. All right, let's talk about my journey. So this picture is from the under 19 Indian camp. One thing I learned over there is this importance of team bonding and communication. So I'm gonna, while telling a story, kind of put in psychology stuff topics, okay? So this picture kind of represents the kind of bond and communication that's important in a team. When we were there, there were people who spoke such different languages. And talking to players was kind of the hindrance. Like, you know, you want to say something, but you're not able to do that. So at this point of time, it's very important for the coach to intervene and get the players to know each other, to break the ice, to make them feel comfortable. Because if this is not there, then no matter how strong your team is, if they're not working together, it's not going to work. This other picture is from my first ever national, as I mentioned, in Chennai. And you can see my face here. I look super scared and super tense, as if I don't know what's going on. You know, when you're in the field, you think like this is the most biggest game of my life. And you take so much stress, you take so much anxiety. And then over time, you look back and say like, okay, it wasn't that bad. So I'll share a story about this particular tournament. There was, it was a festival under 14. And one of the activities was for the goalkeepers called goalie number one. And Nirvan sir will remember this. And he nominated me. I went there and players from all the other states were going to have, you know, like take a shot at the goal. and all the other goalkeepers had to make the save. So I knew my game was good. I knew my diving was good. Diving has always been my favorite thing. And I was ready. But as soon as I stepped into the goal, and he was instructing me from the side, you know, this player, this foot, look there, look there. And I just froze. Like, the shot came, it just went past me. And I was just like, what is happening? What am I doing? And that's when I realized the importance of not just being a good player, having good skills, but being able to perform in that moment. And again, what Amrita ma'am talked about, performance anxiety. If you can be the best player, but once you get out there, if you can't focus, if you can't get your mind to focus on the right thing, on the ball at the right time, no, how many hours of training you've done is not going to work. So just like you train your body and your technique, you also have to train your mind. I want to share this other story with you. So this is from one of my India camp experiences. So what happened on the very first day of my camp was that, you know, when you go out there as players, we always want to give our best. We want to, you know, show our game and show what we got. But sometimes we have to remember what our limitations are, what our boundaries are, not get too excited and not try to overstep. So what happened with me was, we were playing a practice match. I was the goalkeeper representing Maharashtra, and there was another striker from Manipur. Now, as you know, Manipur players, their game is really strong, they're really good, their body is hefty, well-built, and she was coming at me. And I decided that, you know, I'm just going to go for the ball. Now, she was coming, and she took a shot, and I didn't have to dive. The ball was, like, out of my reach. But I decided, no, let's just go for it. Let's just try. And I dived for an unnecessary shot, went beyond my limits, and I got injured. This is the first injury. This is not the picture that I'm talking about. So I got injured in my lips, blood all running down. They stopped the game. I went to the hospital, government hospital, no anesthesia, 3 intern doctors over my head. Aise karna hai, nahi waise karna hai. And trying to find a needle, trying to find a scissor. And one of the most painful experiences of my life. Then coming back to the India camp, and the coach tells me that, Beta, I think you should go home now. And I was so devastated. I'm like, I've come all this way. I want to make it to the team. And now what? So next day I sat out for practice. Next morning also I sat out for practice. And I had a decision to make at that time. I could have gone home, given up, or I could have stayed there, seen how the training went, and tried to give my best. So this is when self-talk comes in. As an athlete, you will always be faced with some important decision at your life. You can choose to keep going and knowing your limitations, or you can choose to give up at that point of time. So I decided that I'll try. And even though I couldn't participate physically at that point, I attended the games, I showed my interest. It's very important to show your interest in the game and tell your coach that, show your motivation as well at that time. So I stayed there, I trained, it was super painful, but I got back into the team. 6 weeks of intense training, and this is where resilience comes in. Things are not going to be easy, but you have to be able to focus your mind on what you want. And that's why your motivation is very important. When you know what you want, you can do anything.
Kunashni, sorry to interrupt you. I think someone is trying to use the screen, and you will have an option of annotation, which you can use as clear annotation and more make option hai. To disable the participant's annotation.
I think I got it.
Yeah, you'll first have to clear it. Clear all the...
Clear?
Yeah, clear all the drawings. Okay. Yeah, and then there's another option. Disable participants' annotation. More mein hoga, more mein. You'll have 3 dots and more. And 5th or 6th option usually is disable the annotation of participants.
Okay.
A lot of people actually access the presentations on mobile. So when they swipe the screen, we can see, you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Right. All right. So moving on, and resilience came in. So I thought, you know, I'm doing good. I've done well. And 6 weeks into the camp, on one of the last few days, again, practice match. I didn't have to go all out. But the player came, one-on-one situation. Again, I wanted to prove that, you know, I can do this. And I go for the ball. She kicks the ball. And instead of hitting the ball, her leg comes and directly hits my face. Her knee bangs straight into my nose. And blood is running down. My jersey is drenched with blood. The ma'am is like, hurry, game roko. Everybody's coming. And the only thing I'm thinking, am I okay? Like, okay, I can breathe. Yes, I'm fine. And everybody's shouting around me. And I myself, I'm just following my breathing. And I'm calm. So that's how I learned to calm myself down in such a situation. Sounds great, right? But since it was only 2 days left of the camp and no time for recovery, I had to be dropped from the team. And that's another story about how we have to learn to deal with disappointments in our life. And no matter, nevertheless, be able to bounce back from injury physically and mentally. Okay. So let's move on. Enough about my stories.
Your stories are very, very interesting, Kunashni.
Thank you. Okay, so let's now talk a little about sports psychology. So we all have physical skills. We all work on our speed. We work on our stamina, on our agility. But and we also work on our technical skills, you know, the right pass, the right, you know, the right header. As goalkeepers, we work on our catching techniques, our diving. We keep practicing these things. But what about our mental skills? Right? And what are these mental skills? What do we do in mental training? So in mental training, we boost our self-confidence. We enhance our concentration. We learn to manage anxiety, set the proper goals. We learn how to deal with the opponents. You know how ma'am said, don't focus on your opponents, focus on what you have, control the controllables. Learn how to always stay motivated and bounce back from injuries like I talked about. And a special thing I put in there, which is how to take a penalty, which we'll discuss at the end. So in sports psychology, we learn to train our mind, understand yourself, learn your weaknesses and your strengths in the game. Like when you go out there, are you overconfident or are you underconfident? Are you anxious? Do you switch off? Know your emotions, know what thoughts are going on in your mind. You have to be able to recognize these during your practice as well, so that when you go on the field, you're more in control of what's going on in here. Because if you can control what's going on in here, it'll be able to show in your game. Let's switch gears right now and talk a little bit about lockdown. So I know we all are stuck at home right now, and as players, it's super difficult because we're super physically active people. We want to get out there. We want to play. Just five things I want to share with you guys about what we can do right now during lockdown. So one is accept. Again, ma'am has talked about this in your match situation, what you can and cannot control. The same in lockdown. You can't control what's going on outside, the number of cases, what the government decides. You can't control that. But what you can control is how you're dealing with yourself every day, how you're managing your work schedule, how you're managing your studies, how you're managing how you're managing your own emotions. So control what you can control, because and know that, you know, this is going to end at some point of time. And when it ends, you're going to think back and be like, what did I do all this time? And you want to answer to your future self that, okay, you know, I took control of the things that I could take control of. Second is know your emotions. Sometimes we behave in ways we don't understand. We talk rudely to people, or, you know, we become angry, we shout, and we don't understand why we're doing this. So learn to recognize your emotions. Are you lonely? Are you frustrated? Are you irritable? What's going on? And try to be conscious of what makes you feel these emotions and what behaviors make you feel better. Does eating something you like make you feel better? Does going for a workout make you feel better? Does talking to friends make you feel better? So be conscious of what is leading to your current emotional state. Recognize what that emotion is and try to monitor how you can change this. Because other people won't understand, you know, why is she so irritable? Why is he, you know, so upset and angry? You can answer that yourself. So always be conscious of what are the things in your environment and your own thoughts that are triggering certain emotions. Third thing is try to establish a routine. So have a daily or weekly checklist. So when you wake up in the morning, have in mind, you know, two, three things. Okay, this is what I'm going to do today. Something as simple as, you know, I'm going to, you know, check my emails. I'm going to finish one chapter of studying. You know, just small goals. So you have something to keep you going. Even if you get distracted, you go back to your checklist. Okay, I've not done that. Let's make time for that. And then by the time it's evening, you feel like, okay, you know, kuch to kiya hai maine aaj. So you feel good. And if you, I mean, it's completely all right to, you know, relax, take a break. But at the same time, having a routine will always keep you on track. Fourth thing is keep socially connected. Right now, it's social distancing, but it's actually physical distancing. We still can be socially connected. Talk to your family, talk to your friends, you know, have video calls, have webinars. Yesterday, we had a talk with the Liverpool women's coach, and she talked about some really great things that the women's team are doing. You know, they're having like bake-off challenge and cooking challenges and having these online workouts. So it's like you can totally take control of how connected you want to be with your coach, with your teammates, with your friends. All it takes is a call, a video call, and it'll honestly make you feel more positive and more connected. And the last thing is have this balance between binging and building. So don't be super productive. I have to do all this. I have to learn a new language. I have to master all these cooking dishes. You know, it's lockdown. Like, I'm going to come out like with all these super skills. Calm down. But at the same time, don't binge on Netflix for like 4 or 5 hours. Don't get, you know, sucked into social media. It's fun. It's good for a short while. But if you do it continuously for a long number of hours, it might feel good during that time, but once you're done with it, you're going to feel drained, mentally and emotionally drained. So keep a check and try to give yourself a limit. Okay, 1 hour I'll spend on this, and then let me find time to do something else. So have this balance between binging and building on yourself. Okay, that's all that there is about the lockdown. Okay, so since this is a seminar, a webinar about women, let's talk a little bit about psychology of women. And the research shows that women do have lower levels of self-confidence when facing tougher opponents compared to men. So when the opponent is tougher, women are more likely to feel underconfident, and the confidence does vary with the situation. So for example, if they hear that, you know, their opponent lost the last match, they'll feel okay, I'm doing good. So this factor is seen more variable in women, whereas in men, they're more stable to such environmental changes in information from the environment. And these differences are thought to be theorized to be based on evolutionary factors, or, you know, biological differences in our brain, and also a lot of social conditioning. You know, over the years, we're taught, you know, men are stronger, sports is for men, don't kick like a girl. So there's a lot of social conditioning that goes on. So these are changes that shows. And this does not only reflect in sport, but it's also, there's also evidence, you know, in science, when applying for jobs, women tend to underestimate their abilities. One study showed that when applying for a job, if men meet just 50% of the criteria, they'll still apply for it and give it a shot. But women are more likely to apply only if they meet all the 100% criteria of what it takes, what the person is looking for in that job role. So the self-confidence factor of selling yourself and putting yourself out there is definitely an advantage that has been there in men for the past few years. And this is something that women would need to work on. So it comes to the question, does this mean that women need more mental training? Is sports psychology only for women? Absolutely not. It just means that men and women possibly might have different skills to work on. When one needs to work on self-confidence and, you know, removing self-doubt and putting themselves out there, men perhaps need to work on things like anger management and, you know, regulating their aggression levels and their arousal levels. So this is definitely a field for all, but there are definitely differences. Okay, so let's now, lockdown over, let's talk about match preparation. In a few weeks, we are going to get back out to the field. We're going to start playing as players. We're going to start training on the pitch again. As coaches, we're going to start our coaching. As all the support staff, we're going to be back out there again. So how do we prepare? First of all, mental preparation does not start the night before. Just as your physical training, do you start doing crunches the day before? Or do you start, you know, learning your dribbling or passing skills the night before? No, it doesn't work that way. Similarly, to build your confidence, to build your concentration ability, it has to be over weeks. It has to be over months. It doesn't happen, okay, kal match hai, let's have a sports psychology session. It doesn't work like that. Okay. So, yes, that's why you get a sports psychologist. Okay. let's talk about motivation. So motivation, how do you always stay motivated? One is know your why. If you know why you're doing something, nobody or nothing can ever take you off your game. You'll always have that stimulus to wake up to in the morning. Your dream, your goal. Second is a concept called locus of control. Now, sometimes we have an internal locus of control and sometimes we have an external locus of control. What does this mean? So let's take a player who's a striker who's playing, and say that striker has missed their shot. You know, they're ready, they're running. They have the ball at their feet. They can see the goal, but they just miss and the ball goes off. So what are the things this player could say? He could say that, you know, I didn't concentrate enough. Or I was too tired. Or, you know, I didn't work hard enough. So all these reasons are internal reasons. He's saying that the mistake was in me and he's internalizing it. Or he could have an external locus of control. He could place the control on environmental factors. He could say, "Arey, yeah, the referee was biased. You know, the crowd was too distracting. It was too hot." So these are all external reasons. So how do we give the reason to the situation that happened? So research shows that if you have a more internalized locus of control, internal reasons, if you give the responsibility to yourself, you'll be more motivated to change. Because if we believe we can change something, only then we'll work towards changing it. If we think it's out of our control, we're not going to work on changing it. We can't change what the referee does or what the crowd does. So always find that reason within yourself so you can be motivated to change it. A little bit about performance pressure. So when it comes to playing, we have to be able to do things like blocking out negative thoughts and focusing on the goal. This happens a lot through positive self-talk training. It's what you tell yourself in your mind. And again, this doesn't happen just in the match. It happens over a period of weeks. And how do we work on this? Through journaling, reflecting, self-talk analysis. Ma'am shared a gratitude journaling thing. So this is things that we work on. And finally, two other mental training tasks which you can do daily is goal setting and visualization. So I'll talk a little bit in detail about these two things. And these are things you guys can start working on right now itself. Like I said, in a few weeks, we're going to get back out there. And I know everyone's working on their, you know, physical skills and a little bit of passing here and their technical skills. But let's try to also work on our mental game. And how do we do that? So one is having the right goals. Your goals should definitely be specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time-bound. These are SMART goals. You can't just say, "Now I want to become the best player." How are you going to become the best player? Have you thought about the process, that the steps that go into it? To break these things down. Other types of goals are outcome goals. I want to be the best player. Process goals. How? By training. Performance goal. By training how much? By training 2 hours a day. By doing so many number of drills. And then have short-term, medium, and long-term goals. Today, what am I going to achieve today? Okay, in a week, how much am I going to achieve? So if you have these big, huge goals in your life, it's going to seem very daunting. But if you break them down to small things and try to just focus on that small goal every day, each day, it's going to be much easier. And you can start that right today by asking yourself, what is my goal of today? Okay, I want to get selected into the state team. I say a few months from now when the trial is there, okay, that's my long-term outcome goal. But what is my performance goal right now? How will I get selected? What am I going to work on right now? What is my weakness? Is it my passing? Is it my first touch? What is it? Note these things down. Be aware of these weaknesses. So that's a little bit about goal setting. Finally, this comes to my favorite topic, which is visualization. And this is the best practice you can do as an athlete. Absolutely the best practice. And it just takes 10 minutes of your time every day. So how do you do this? Now, while you're working on your physical workout, try to put 10 minutes of this mental workout also in your day, and it's definitely going to help you. So how do you do this? Close your eyes within those 10 minutes. Imagine yourself in a game situation, performing a specific task, like passing, dribbling, shooting, heading, whatever it is, you know, diving. And just completely immerse yourself into that and ask yourself and try to visualize, you know, who's around me? Where's the ball? Where can I move? How can I do something differently? What's going to happen next? Try imagining all these different scenarios and how you would respond to that situation. And then visualize the outcome. You know, are people cheering? Did you score the goal? Did you save the goal? Was your tackle really good? Is your player coming and giving you a high five? You know, imagine all this happening and use all your senses. So, you know, use your visual processing, like you can see it, try imagining what you can hear. Can you hear your coach? Can you hear your players? Can you hear the sound of the ball? What are the things you feel? Do you feel excited? Do you feel proud? You just close your eyes and really immerse yourself into this experience. And what are the things you can touch? Like, can you feel, like, if you're falling, can you feel the ground? Have this complete sensory experience. Why is this important? Because I'll tell you something about our brain. So our brain works in such a way that when you visualize this entire experience and when you actually are doing it, there's no difference in your brain. Your brain thinks that it's actually happening. So the same neurons which are there in your prefrontal cortex and your amygdala, all these other regions, they are being activated in the same way as if actually you're performing out there. So just by visualizing, you're already training yourself. So when you're out there in that actual situation, it's going to be much smoother and much better. And you'll know how to react when you visualize all these different scenarios. And keep doing this again and again. Repetition, you'll feel good, you feel great, and you feel like you're back there in the game. So that's a little bit about visualization. Just a small, brief introduction. There's a lot more to talk about all these psychological techniques. These are some Q&As that I won't talk right now, but you can have a look at them. And if anybody has these questions, we can bring it up and talk about these. Yes, and that is the end of my session.
Thank you so much, Kunashni. That was excellent. And coming from you, who's actually been there, done that, and now you are in a position to be actually helping people who will probably be in the same position. It's really an amazing thing. And I'm so glad to have you on this platform where you can actually reach out to people and help them in this situation. All of you, please have a look at these questions. And if anyone wants to ask any of these questions, just raise your hand. I just have one question for Amruta right now. Amruta, I need to ask you, Kunashri, can you please stop screen sharing? Yeah, thank you. Amruta?
Yes.
Question is going out to you. What is the right age to actually expose a player to sports psychology?
Okay. Basically, generally kids start playing sports at age 5 or 6 or 7, competitive by the age of 8, 9, 10. Lot of them start later on in their age, say 12 or 14. In my practice, I usually start taking up cases from age 10 onwards. Yeah, because psychology is a subject which is with a lot of abstract, it involves a lot of abstract thinking. Yeah. So a lot of times the child needs that kind of a developmental, to reach that developmental stage where they will be able to understand what we're trying to say. Nevertheless, as I said, that a parent and a coach are very important in bringing up an athlete. Kids below the age of 10, even if they are not exposed much to mental training, the parents and coaches are handled or are taught how to develop a champion or how to develop an athlete. Yeah. So there are behavioral techniques taught to parents and coaches to groom or to create an environment where a good player can be developed. Yes. So, there have been instances where I've had an 8 and 9 year old chess player who's playing at world level, but his intellectual capacity was at a level where he could, kind of understand, was able to express, was able to, speak out what he or she was feeling. So in that case, yes, we got him into the process. But again, the role of parents and coaches was equally important. So in that boy's case, there was a super strict, abusive coach and a super ambitious helicopter parenting kind of a, couple who had a lot of ambition for their son. And the son was an 8-year-old chess player who would sit for at least 14 hours a day playing chess. Yes, and he would start playing chess like this, and at the end of the day, he used to be like this. Yeah, an 8-year-old child is all full of energy, wants to explore, play, do a lot of stuff, but was not led to. And not just that, when he was not performing to his best due to the pressure of coach. Yeah. So parents to sirf coaching ke liye pressure karte, but the coach was extremely abusive. So jab maar dete the bache ko, so he used to be really frightened. So in this case, like, it is not just about training the child, but it is also about getting the coach and the parents into the ecosystem. So for me, I generally ask for students to join in sessions at age 10 or above. And before that, it's a major role of coaches and parents who need to understand the science of sports psychology and bring it in their daily, day-to-day functioning. I hope I could answer your question.
Yes, perfectly. That's a perfect answer. And I hope a lot of coaches out there are listening to this and will take further interest in how they can become better coaches, looking at psychology as an aspect. My next question again is actually related to something you just said about helicopter parents. So initially when parents bring the child to the coach, of course, the first few weeks, the first few months, they are very cooperative and they are very supportive and everything. And of course, that all particularly ends after the first match that the child plays. And let's imagine if the child doesn't play well, and then that's the end. Then the parent takes over, he becomes the coach, and he starts telling the coach what to do, and he starts telling the coach what he thinks or she thinks is the best position to play in, and starts telling the referee how to referee, basically just tries to take control. Now, this has a very wrong impact on the child's mind. How do we deal with the situation?
Okay, so first and foremost thing, if you are asking me this question as a coach, because currently in my 12 years of practicing, one of the biggest challenges that coaches have is not about training kids, but handling parents. Okay, so if you're asking me as a question with perspective of a coach, then it is important to understand about this type of helicopter parenting, where the parent is too involving and trying to control everything, and you have to have a one-on-one meeting with the parent, speak about what are the consequences of this kind of a behavior, not just on the child but the process of coaching. And it's a long-term perspective. You know, sports is not about a destination, it's a journey. Yeah, so how helicopter parenting can have an impact on the fun and excitement or enjoyment of the child, and how there could be early burnout, quitting of the child. And not just that, a lot of times it could lead to a lot of internal clashes between the team, parents, coaches. So it's about speaking to the parent. If the coach is not in a position or gets either aggressive or is submissive, is not able to be assertive, then, and like you know, you have said that you know, sports psychologist, you were the pioneer in getting sports psychologist in the football women's team almost in 2011. I feel sports psychologist or a sports science specialist, all the team has to be with every team. So to know when to refer a parent or a case to a sports psychologist, so that the sports psychologist can handle this topic and the coach can focus on his expertise of coaching. Today what has happened is I have 50 students with me and I have 100 parents with me. I am good at coaching, but I'm doing everything except coaching, because I have to handle my kids' behavioral issues. I have to handle parents. I have to handle their expectations, which start becoming demands. And these demands affect the mental health of a coach. If the coach is not in his best, mental health status, even that affects the performance of the players and the team. So here there has to be coaching philosophy developed of our dear coaches, where they should know what are the limits he or she wants to set for himself, the athletes and parents. Kaun se topic pe parents baat kar sakte hain, kab baat kar sakte hain, kitna baat kar sakte hain. There are certain rules that coaches have to set up and also keep a close connection with द अलाइड स्पोर्ट्स साइंटिस्ट. क्या खाना है ये कोच को पता है, बट इट्स नॉट इम्पॉर्टेंट एवरी टाइम द कोच डिसाइड्स and what not. There's a sports nutritionist who can do it. वैसे ही, if there is a challenge at the psychological level, the referral to a sports psychologist will make the coach little more relieved and focus on his skills and development. And the psychologist can work on these matters and as a team, they can work together. So with respect to helicopter parenting, confronting, meeting the parent, discussing, in the worst scenario, confronting, or the most important thing is to refer this case to a psychologist. Yeah, it is a team effort, and together as a team, we can resolve to make sure that the child performs to the best. Yes, I hope, ma'am, you are muted, so you'll have to unmute yourself.
That's an absolute lovely answer, Amruta. We have a question from Kashvi. Kashvi, go ahead, ask your question, and please introduce yourself, and please let us know who you are addressing the question to.
Okay, ma'am.
And put on your video. We're going to see you. Yeah. Kashvi?
Yes.
Yeah, ask your question.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask the question to Kunashree ma'am. The question is ki, like in the situation where she got hurt, so is it right to go back, or you know, you should stay where you are? Like if, for example, if I get an injury and that injury is really very, you know, at an intensive state. So like she got the fracture. So what should I do at that time? Like, what should the people or what should the footballers do at that time? Like, should they go back, or, you know, they should stay there at that situation?
Kunashree?
So definitely when you have an intense injury, you should not continue playing, because that will aggravate your injury even more and it will even destroy your career, sports career even further. So when you hit a very serious injury, okay, small scratches here and there, obviously, let's get back, let's play. But when something serious happens, or, you know, medium to serious, like, you know, pull your hamstring or, you know, sprain your ankle, definitely stop, take a break, recover. And what to do during that time? So in my case, because I had a serious fracture, I was out of the game for at least 4-5 months before I could start, like, you know, basic training again. So when you're in this time, you have to keep yourself fit in other ways, keep, you know, small light jogging, this, that, whatever the doctor recommends. So you have to take care of your physical health first and listen to the medical advice of your doctors. At the same time, work on your mental game. Don't try to get disappointed. Know that you are getting back out there, and you might have a lot of self-doubt that, you know, I've missed so much training. Everyone has done so much. They're going to go ahead of me. What do I do? But you have to know that you are going to get back. You're going to get that chance again. And when you get that chance, you'll be able to give your best. But if you don't recover during that time, you won't be able to come back mentally or physically. You definitely serious injury, take a break.
Kashvi, does that answer your question?
Anjali ma'am, I'll just add, Kunashree absolutely perfectly said, and she has gone through it, you know, and she's from the same spot. So there are, these inputs are very, very important. Those players, you know, when I'm speaking to a cyclist or a triathlete or a swimmer, my inputs are taken more, you know, or internalized, because they can connect. So with her feedback, it's absolutely bang on. I'm just wanting to throw some light on what Kunashree was saying, was the psychological rehabilitation. So injury sirf physical nahi hota hai. There is either fear, there is either, the anxiety that others may go ahead, you may be dropped in. Yeah. So it is a perfect time. Probably you will not be able to work on the physical or technical skills, but injury is one of the best times for an athlete to work on their mental skills. So she beautifully explained a visualization. Visualization helps you have more productive thoughts, feel more in control. That leads to faster recovery also, and also keeps you, your muscle memory intact. You are way within the training zone in spite of not being physically moving even an inch. So like she rightly said, you know, take it easy, but the psychological rehabilitation is also equally important. Players have to identify parents and coaches. do not rush in, because injuries are a part, but a lot of times re-injury happens because you rush into a spot before you are actually prepared for it.
Thank you so much, Amrita. We had one more person who had their hand up. Who was it? Jigmit. Can we have Jigmit on? Jigmit? Yeah, Jigmit, can you go ahead and ask your question?
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello? Yes, hello?
Just introduce hello? Yourself, who you are, where you are from, where do you play?
Hello, everyone. I'm Jigmit Palmo from UT Ladakh. And I want to ask questions to Amrita ma'am. Ma'am, everyone used to watch matches with friends, whether it is a football match or cricket match. So why do we enjoy watching sports more in groups or friends rather than alone?
Such a lovely question, Jigmit. Lovely question. Amrita?
Yes. So, you know, sports psychology was started as a field specifically because it was noticed that when you do certain activity together as a as a team, or probably a lot of people together, you experience less fatigue. You're able to do an activity for a prolonged level. So this is from the athlete point of view, and that's where the father of sports psychology he identified ki aisa kaise hota hai ki wahi workout जब एक साथ मिलके कर रहे हैं देन प्लेयर्स आर एक्सपीरियंसिंग लेस फटीग. यू आर स्पीकिंग अबाउट व्यूइंग अ मैच. या सो व्हेन वी आर व्यूइंग अ मैच और व्हेन यू एंड देयर इज अ बिग डिफरेंस बिटवीन इंडिविजुअल गेम एंड अ टीम गेम. या सो यू नो इन इंडिविजुअल गेम्स द सक्सेस और फेलियर आर बोथ बिकॉज ऑफ योर एक्शंस. या सो एंजाइटी लेवल्स आर हायर इन इंडिविजुअल गेम्स than in group games, because in group it gets distributed. Okay, so I'm not speaking about the blame game, but the anxiety, the pressure gets distributed amongst different players. So when you're playing an individual and a team games are preferred more because they are less anxiety provoking, and there are people whom together can help you achieve success. When you're talking about viewers, or when you're talking about viewing it together, there are n number of emotions that you experience, and there are people who are experiencing it together. Yeah. So you like to experience, since I said that human beings are social beings, we like to experience situations together, and there is a fluctuation. I mean, Krishna Kushani will be better in, yeah, I'm so sorry, I make up I jumble when I speak about your name. I think I should also call you Kunnu, like Anjali ma'am says, but she will be able to explain more about the dopamine or the chemical neurotransmitter fluctuations that come along when you see a physical activity or a match. Yeah, so it helps you feel more positive emotions together, and that is why you enjoy looking at it together than alone. Yeah, so there is a good amount of the neural connections, the neurotransmitters have a big role to play, and they have a direct impact on your emotional status. And when sports activity, whether you're doing it or playing it, like she said, visualizing is about not moving even an inch, but you can, your mind will feel as if it is true. So when you're watching a match, you kind of feel the same excitement that as if you are playing a match. Yes, now that brings all those emotions in audience, and viewing it together is always fun. Kya bolte hai? Unknown people ho ya known people ho, it gives you that high. Yes, and that's why I think it's always good to have a lot of people together watching the matches, and people are crazy about football, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Kunni, would you like to add something to that?
Yes, she would.
It's just a small thing. You know, why do we love watching sports together? There's something about sports just in general. Sports is a community thing. It's something that connects you to something even bigger. That's why when we watch teams at the national level or competing internationally, you feel a part of a larger community. Now, your team is playing. You feel connected. You feel belongingness. And as ma'am correctly said, we are social beings. You know, we like to feel connected. And we feel all these emotions. And we just like to feel connected to something that is bigger than us. Even as an athlete, you play a sport not just for the physical game, but because you're representing something. And that feeling you don't get anywhere else. You can watch a movie also together, right? But watching a match together is a completely different feeling. Like, I remember once at a sports bar, there was this group of people watching. My brother was there. He was a Liverpool fan. And he was watching it with some, you know, other stranger people who he didn't know. And they were like, you know, come on, let's score, score, score. And as soon as the team scored, they looked at each other. They didn't know each other. They just hugged each other. And they started jumping in excitement. So it creates this bond where there are none, because we have something to connect with each other and share with. And you can also, you know, talk to people. You don't understand something. Why was that a foul? Why was that? So you can also understand more things about the game when you watch it together.
Kunashni, that's absolutely true what you are saying, because even what we are doing on this platform is gathering a whole bunch of people collectively who want to see Indian women's football do well. There are so many people who I do not know personally, but now over the couple of sessions that they have all been participating, I feel that I know all of you, and I believe that all of you are going to be a part of taking this responsibility of helping India qualify for the World Cup very seriously. The next question coming in is from Leah to you, Kunashni.
Hi. I just want to start by telling everyone over here, like, what an incredible goalkeeper Kunashni was. Like, I remember her diving in all directions with absolutely no fear when we played state together. And I'm so happy, and I'm so, like, inspired to see you actually following your passion in sports psychology. But back to my question. As many people do, I sometimes tend to get, like, super frustrated in my football games, especially when we're losing. I know you're laughing at that.
IWL, three offsides.
And as a captain, although many times it may not work, like, I've tried my best to not get angry or not to blame my teammates. And I try to take on that responsibility myself, and I tell myself that, you know, we're losing because I'm doing something wrong, like, as a captain and not my teammates. And this obviously puts a lot of pressure on myself and therefore will negatively affect the quality of my game. But, you know, at the same time, I don't want to put that pressure on my teammates. So, like, how do I mentally deal with such a situation?
Right. So when you're in that situation, I understand that first of all, it's very important as a captain and as a player to control your anger on the field and try to delay your response and not say something that you might regret later to your players. So keeping calm is important. And I think another very important point for players, you know, like yourself, Leah, who are super motivated and super, what should I say, like, you know, takes a responsibility on themselves. You have to take the load of yourself. You have to share the load with your team, because you might be the captain, but it's not an individual sport. It is a team sport, and you have to understand what the roles of a captain are and what the limitations of a captain are. Being a captain means, you know, talk to your coach and try to understand. Does it mean, you know, motivating your players? Yes. Does it mean, you know, inspiring them to work together, integrating the team? Yes. But when you take a loss, does it mean taking all that responsibility on yourself? No, not necessarily. So we do this a lot in our lives when, you know, something goes wrong. It's like, you know, we criticize ourselves, and this is called something called as negative bias. A victim syndrome, and kind of like, sorry, not a victim syndrome, but kind of taking all that blame onto yourself. So you have to understand that despite being the captain and all the great things that you are doing for the team, this is not a load that you have to carry yourself, because it will lead to mental burnout. So share the load with your players, and trust me, they will also want to share that load. You know, they don't want you to take that load. You might feel that it's your responsibility, but just talking about it as a team. And I think a very important thing about this is, when you look at yourself as a captain, look at yourself at the same level of your team. If you look at yourself as somebody, you know, higher, you will start taking more of that responsibility. But that's not the role of a captain. We are at that level with all the players, and it's about sharing the wins and the losses. Yeah.
Got it.
Any other questions, Leah?
Yes, I have another question about like the importance of warm-up. I know the warm-up is I mean, people think it's mainly for a physical warm-up to stretch and warm up your muscles for the game so that you don't get injured. But I don't think a lot of players know the importance of it because of the how it helps you mentally. And I play in a lot of like amateur tournaments, like the Roots Premier League in Mumbai. And I mean, even though it's an amateur game, how can you make other people understand in a healthy manner, like without shouting at them or lecturing them, like how important the warm up and pre-game prep is mentally?
I think the best way to convince people to do anything is by sharing an example where when you didn't do something, how badly it went wrong. That's one great way of telling people that I think to do is. And why is it important to have that mental, to have that warm up before the game? Of course, to you know get your body running as well. But when you start warming up, it also activates your mind. When your body temperature goes up, when your breathing rate increases, it you know our brain is kind of like at a frozen level. But once it starts kicking in, all our neurotransmitters start activating. Your mind is also focused. So you can be like physically charged, but you really need to be mentally charged as well. Because the ball will come and you'll be like, wait, what just happened? Mm-hmm. So it's super important that I think you know the importance of it. The only way of convincing them is to tell them situations where it's wrong and really drill that into their head.
Can I also add in, because this is a very nice question that she's asked in. Kunya, I'm just going to speak your smaller version of name. I'm so sorry, I mess it up and I really don't like it. Okay, so why is warm-up important, or how does it affect mind? Okay, so you are playing a team game and all team players are of different personality. They are different individuals with different arousal levels. Okay, so a lot of times people feel that only being anxious or pressurized affects performance. But there are certain times under arousal. That means when your system has not kicked in, the fight and flight mode ruins your performance, but it is also required that you have optimal level of stress to actually get you to your best performance. And how do you make your body come out of that inactivity into an optimal level of arousal is by having a good warm-up. So when you're doing warm-up, there are physiological changes which brings changes in your mind. It kind of prepares your mind to raise that arousal level to an optimal level. So psyching up, jise kehte hai, the warm-up does the work of psyching up. Now, for those who are anxious people, even for them, warm-up actually, when the heart rate increases, and then when you slowly get into a routine, helps you come out of those anxious thoughts. Anxiety, fear, pressure is all because of negative thoughts. Once you get into your routine, the thoughts pass away and you get into your warm-up related thoughts more connected to your body. So the high anxiety people can also benefit from warm-ups, because generally when the anxiety is high, they would tend to miss out on warm-up, tend to skip it, tend to do it half-heartedly. So a good warm-up helps reduce anxiety also, and good warm-up helps players with low activation level to get their activation level to an optimal level. Yeah? And also with respect to your role as a captain, you've been kind enough to accept that if the game is not going your way, it is your responsibility. But somewhere, players have shown high tendency of perfectionism, where they are too demanding on themselves. Yeah. So you are responsible, but not to an extent where it starts affecting you. सो लॉट ऑफ पीपल फील परफेक्शनिज्म मीन्स परफेक्ट होना चाहिए, तो नहीं. परफेक्शनिज्म इज अ पर्सनालिटी ट्रेट वेयर यू काइंड ऑफ सेट एक्सट्रीमली हाई स्टैंडर्ड्स फॉर योरसेल्फ. सो यू वांट टू प्रोबेबली नॉट गिव दैट गिल्ट टू एनी अदर प्लेयर एंड यू जस्ट वांट टू टेक ऑल द लोड. इज अ एक्सट्रीमली हाई स्टैंडर्ड यू आर सेटिंग ऑन योरसेल्फ एंड व्हेन यू बिकम क्रिटिकल. सो द नेक्स्ट एलिमेंट ऑफ यू नो व्हाट हर्ट्स योर परफॉर्मेंसेस और हाउ व्हाई यू गेट अफेक्टेड इज यू हैव अ क्रिटिकल सेल्फ टॉक. सो यू गेट इनटू अ क्रिटिकल सेल्फ टॉक which affects you. So ye dono milke, yani you have set a high standard for yourself, you are criticizing yourself. Now this leads to stress, and then the stress leads to more fight and flight mode. You get into a vicious cycle and you get affected. Yeah, so my suggestion to you is, I think you are an player, you are a captain if I'm not wrong of a team, so it is important to understand that mental training off field is important to get you mentally tough on field. गुस्सा नहीं होना है तो उसका ट्रेनिंग बाहर होना चाहिए, तो ही वो ऑन ऑफ बटन फील्ड पे हो पाएगा. यस, सो वर्क ऑन योर मेंटल साइड ऑफ फील्ड एंड मेक इट सो ऑटोमेटिक. सो आई विल गिव यू एन एग्जांपल. व्हेन यू स्टार्ट ड्राइविंग अ व्हीकल, यू आर सुपर कॉन्शियस, यू विल नॉट लुक हियर एंड देयर. किसी का फोन आए तो भी यू विल नॉट लुक. आफ्टर सम डेज व्हेन यू आर लिटिल यू नो कंफर्टेबल विद ड्राइविंग, यू विल यू नो टेक योर कॉल्स ऑन मोबाइल. After some days, you take a call and aram se drive the vehicle. Why? Because once you master a skill, the cognitive energy that is required for that element reduces. So you can do multiple things at a time. Yes? So likewise, ye automatize hone ke liye, your mental training has to be automatic on field. You are not going there for mental training match. You are going there for football match. Yeah? So mental training has to happen off field, and then you will see the benefit of it on field. And sorry, Anjali ma'am, there is a private chat pay. 2-3 questions have come. At the end, we will please take them, because the girl is continuously asking me if we can address that question.
Definitely, we are taking on Vinay next. Vinay?
Yes.
Yeah, please go ahead and ask your question. Then introduce yourself, please, and put on your video.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
Anjali Tai, first of all, hats off to you. I'm from Pune.
Thank you.
And I've met you personally with Aishwarya Balapure.
Yes.
Who got the best player award for the FIFA thing.
Yes.
But all cut short and talk to these wonderful ladies here, two young ladies, very enterprising. You have got people who can open the hearts of Indian women's football. And hearts and brains of Indian women's football, and that's exceptional. So I personally, with my wife, who's been working with me for the past 25 years, and we've been running a program for the slum girls. You know, so unfortunately, she had breast cancer last year, but she's recovering from it, and we are doing a stupendous job here. But the biggest challenge is that we selected 25 slum girls last year. From Vadarwadi, which is now a red zone for the COVID-19. And they are all stuck inside. And we are constantly with them on the phone, but they don't have Android phones. Right? Yes. And the way it happened was, we could not provide them with the equipment when everything was locked down. And unfortunately, they are stuck there. And we are only we can only communicate to individuals through their cell phones, you know. And they are not able to do any activity around. So at this point in time, with those girls stuck there, because they have undergone training for 1 year. Okay. And this was the second year which was going to start training. And fortunately, now this thing has come up. So I wanted to ask Kushni and Amruta and you, Anjali, Anjali ma'am, as to how do we get across to them, and how do we, you know, do what we can do to normal people who have Android phones and stuff like that. Is there a remedy for it? Because we together, me and Anu, we keep trying try and find activities for them and talk to them and, you know, do a lot of things. But what we can do scientifically, technically, you know, to keep them on their toes?
Amruta, would you like to take that question?
Yeah. Yeah, firstly, sir, thank you for such a wonderful and a touchy question. Yeah, I hope your wife recovers fast from her cancer and she's able to again get into the training mode. The question was, how can we be able to train these girls with whom you have taken effort for almost 1 year? Yes, and they don't have Android phones. So how do we make sure that they do their routines? And what can we do from the mental training point of view? So if I have to put the first and the foremost thing is, sir, understanding the situation they might be in. Training might not be the first priority at this point in time, but to understand the emotional roller coaster rides they may be going through, or the basic needs. They are slum girls, so I'm sure the food, shelter, the basic needs must have been affected. Since they are in slums, a lot of people who get affected, who die, may cause a lot of emotional emotions which they might be experiencing. And at this point of time, understanding these emotional issues and giving them the support being able to be there for them in the worst scenario will be the second action that you will be required to do with them. The third thing is about having one-on-one sessions, like Kunnu said that. Visualization is one of the best ways in which you can still keep in touch with your sport without even moving an inch. It could be physical training, it could be technical training, it could be your dream matches, it could be your goal, anything and everything. But are they in a mental state to really do this? So understanding the current scenario they are in, empathizing with them, which can be better done by a mental health professional. You have n number of mental health institutes who are providing counseling. So identifying if these girls need any kind of helplines are there, or connect them to a sports psychologist or psychologist in general. And then once we see that the mental health status is better, they are in positive mental health status, then working and speaking to them about mental training, probably because they don't have smartphones, it could be a one-on-one call and probably follow up with them. This is what I can tell from my experience. I'm sure Anjali ma'am and Kunu will also have something to speak about. This is what I feel. I know I've been working with an underprivileged institution, and most of my kids have every day some or the other person getting admitted or expiring, and it has an impact on them. So optimism kaise increase kar sakte hain, hope kaise instill kar sakte hain, how they will be able to believe that they are going to come out of it fit and fine should be the first target. And everyone's skills are going for a toss. SAI, Sports Authority of India, had amazing sessions on explaining how athletes all over the world are going to get affected by lockdown, because their skills, their physical skills, their fitness is going to get affected. We will all go through it. We can all build it up later also. What's important at this point in time is to take care of your basic hygiene. Their basic needs are taken care of, and their mental status. Yeah, so I hope I could just give a small piece of what I felt about.
Kunashni, would you like to add something to that?
I think ma'am spoke really well about it. Focusing on their mental health, mental well-being would definitely be the first priority. I think ma'am addressed it really well.
Okay, Vinay, I would like to give you my perspective over there. First of all my good wishes with Anu. I hope she gets well really soon and can be in the thick of the action as soon as possible. Thank you for all your good words, kind words that you gave for me. And I will...
No. Anjali Tai.
And thank you for calling me Anjali Tai.
No, because in the academy, we are all dadas and thais here. We don't call them sirs. We don't call...
beauty of Pune. They don't have the... fear of speaking to their dadas and tais, which generally I always experience सिंपल टॉयलेट जाना है या मेरे पेट में दर्द है, आई हैव मेंसेस, ये बोलने के लिए कोच को मुझे एक हफ्ता लगता था. बट व्हेन यू हैव अ दादा एंड ताई विथ यू, दैट कंफर्ट. सो ऑल माय स्टूडेंट्स, इवन इफ दे आर एल्डर टू मी, कॉल मी अमृता ताई. दैट्स बिकॉज द कंफर्ट दैट इंडियन सोसाइटी और आवर कलेक्टिविस्टिक कल्चर हैज, वेयर यू नो दैट वर्ड गिव्स यू द पावर टू यू नो फील एज इफ यू आर वन. Yes, absolutely. Yeah,
it just came out of my mouth spontaneously.
No, that's perfectly fine, because I'm also a Maharashtrian and I am also called Anjutai by my younger brother, so that is nothing alien to me. Let me explain to you how I have dealt with the problem, with the communicating with our lesser fortunate community members. So PIFA Foundation works with girls in three communities in Mumbai. We work with girls in Colaba, in Grey Road, and in Bayandar. And as you can imagine, it has been very, very difficult to communicate with all of them, because like rightfully you said, everyone does not have a smartphone. See, I actually did exactly what Amruta had suggested. To begin with, our first concern was survival. The first focus question was on survival, because see, I know all these girls very closely and I know enough about their families and their backgrounds to understand that currently their problem would not have been of a lack of training or a lack of exercise. The first thing would be survival, because a lot of these girls' parents are daily wage earners and food was basically a very big problem. So the PIFA Foundation actually ran a campaign where we provided rations to these girls and their families for over a month and a half. So that was the first thing we did. And just by this one gesture of mine, I think majority of my players who are from these communities felt so good that there is someone looking after them. Not only them, they brought in their sisters and their relatives and we provided them rations for a month and a half. Now that is the first thing we addressed. Okay, so after the rations became and the daily meals that we provided them became a little regularized, then my attention went to the mental state, because see, these are players, they are used to training, and I knew in absence of them training, it would have some sort of impact with them. What I personally did is I have community leaders in every area. And my community leaders, with God's grace, have basic smartphones where we would transfer not very high tech, but very basic training material, even if it was like a fun YouTube challenge or some video on fun by having a game, you know, and we would pass this on to the community leader, and the community leader would make sure social distancing was being maintained and would try and keep these girls entertained in a small way, not a very big way. I'm not saying they would gather 20, 30 people, even if it's 4 or 5 girls, but to share some fun fact. We had something called the Lockdown Cup. The Lockdown Cup was a virtual online football tournament that I organized, where we had 12 teams from all over India who took part. And that was all basically physical challenges and football trivia. So we would share these football trivia questions and try and see, you know, if they got some answers, rules of the game, basic, very basic stuff that they were all very used to, in an attempt to try and keep them mentally engaged with football during this time. So I mean, that's what we tried to do. And I'm sure if you would have had the expertise of being able to give them, I'm sure you would have done the same. If you could have connected up with a community leader, with one of those girls. But under these circumstances, I think, I don't think you should feel guilty at all for not being able to having done it, because the focus right now is on survival. And from a coach's point of view, I think if you would even just call these girls up and let them know that you are concerned about them, a simple call like, "Tu bari hai, tu jai vadil bari hai ka," simple, simple question like that will do a lot for the girl, because at the end of the day, everyone wants to know that, you know, someone cares about them, and it's not about just being a football player, but also a family member of an extended family, which is your team. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, yes, Anjutai, that is wonderful. That was really massive. We are doing that. We are communicating with them daily, on a daily basis, on the phone. We talk to each one of them. In fact, we also sorted out one of the girls' menstruation problems. You know, she was not having periods for the past 9 months, and we got a sonography done and stuff like that. But we are doing that. But what I was talking to the sports psychologist you have invited is how to help them mentally. Is there a step-by-step approach for these kinds of girls? Because as you know, Anjutai, these are the girls, why girls from Manipur come and do well, so well at the national level. You know, similarly, these girls who are from the slums are from the backgrounds of Ramoshi. They come from a community known as Vadari. They come from a community which is known as Billa. You know, these are all aggressive, having aggressive genetics. You know, these communities are very, very strong.
These are almost like communities that keep migrating from one place to the other, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, but they are very aggressive. It's like if you talk about dogs, the Rottweiler is one of the most aggressive breeds.
Yeah.
Because they have those genetics. These are the girls who come from those communities. And suddenly when they are locked down with men in the house, you know, because you know how men are.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
One track. So yeah. With alcohol habits and other habits, you know, they survive. Their survival instincts are very high. These girls are very, very strong mentally. But what happens is, you know, they are superstitions and all those kinds of things that we are working on. So what I was requesting these two sports psychologists is if they can bring about a program for these girls, because I and Anu work for these kids. We do cross-subsidization. We cross-subsidize 50% of the money we earn from children from good families towards raising these kids. And the 50% we run our home. So we don't have corporate, government or political or religious affiliation or any funding. So if these ladies could help us with a small program, which could help us during lockdown, then we can, you know, it's always the privileged who get the benefits.
Absolutely.
What about these kids?
Amruta?
Absolutely, absolutely. I will just forward you my number and email ID. As you said, you want a structured program or a step-by-step procedure. Surely, you're doing a good work and would surely like to contribute as a social responsibility towards your organization and towards these girls. So I will send you my email ID. If you can just, help me with what exactly you're looking at, we can discuss it and then I will surely help you about that.
Amruta, I will also email you because I have had similar questions from a lot of NGOs. Mm-hmm. I will put it all together in an email and send it to you. Then you can customize some sort of program.
Absolutely.
And, we will share it with everyone.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah? Okay. I think we have one last question from...
Paratikta, Zaycha Agudar Anjutai. Shata Shata Pranam.
Thank you
very much from Anu, me and the kids.
Thank you so much and keep up your good work. And I hope you become a part of our alliance, because all of us together are going to try and take Indian women's football to the next level. And I will be considering you one of my important pillars from Pune.
Yes.
Okay. We have one last question from Ranjini Dasgupta. Both of you can answer this. Does menstruation affect the psychological aspect of a woman while playing a match?
Yes. So first and the foremost thing, it does. I am not going to say no, because the menstrual cramps due to blood loss, the kind of fatigue that a person feels is genuine. It is individualistic, so it is different for every person, which cannot be generalized. But then, like I have said, it's a part and parcel of a girl's life and a female athlete's life. And how they take it up? Are they looking it as a challenge or are they looking it as an opportunity to work over it is very, very important. So is it, it's a factor beyond control, but what you think, how you take care, the required rest, the nutrition, when you get yourself into training, how much you put in your effort, those factors within your control are certain things that you can do. So for sure, yes, menstruation has an impact. You are emotionally a little more sensitive. The pain makes you little more irritable or emotional. We have heard about PMS where, you know, there are changes in your mood swings. Yeah, so Kunu had already said that females are different from males, and so working with females are different. So menstruation is also a part, a very important process that a female's physiology goes through. Oh, someone started the screen. Okay.
No, fine.
Okay, so it is important to understand, help the player, focus on right things, factors within control, and make sure that the choices taken. So as I said, rest, the food, the amount of exertion and recovery is taken care of, which will help the person at least give optimal level of performance, if not the best kind of a stuff. Yes, it might certain times lead to a little mediocre performance, but for sure, it can work upon what you focus on. So right focus is important. So if I have, this is what I have to say. I think Kunu will be able to also answer this.
I think I agree with all of that. It definitely affects your game emotionally and physically. You do feel a bit more drained out. It's okay to take rest and step back for a few days for that. Also to just recognize your moods and know that don't feel guilty, don't feel bad, you know, that you won't be able to do something. It's okay. You're going to get back. And I think another point I want to cover in this is that menstruation affecting a player's game is a super important topic, and this should be discussed with the players' coaches as well. Sometimes, you know, as girls, and especially when there are male coaches, we don't really like to approach this topic or share this information. We shy away from talking about these things. But it is important, and that's why having a women's coach is also super helpful, because as women, we realize the menstrual cycle and all the changes that go in the body about these things. I think if coaches educate themselves about these symptoms that happen, they can be more sensitive to the player's needs and also help them deal with it in an effective way. So I think this communication gap should also be filled in addition to everything else that ma'am said.
Definitely. We will make sure that we do our best to educate everyone about this and basically get everyone to be a little more sensitive. One last question. After many attempts to score goals, when we fail, we become discouraged. So what should be done at that point of time in the match? This is from Dakshata.
Okay. I'll start with that question. So firstly, when you're trying again and again in the match and you're failing, of course, you have to analyze where you're going wrong. Definitely your physical skills, your technical skills, you have to work on. Let's assume that your physical skills are solid and your technical game is good. You know how to shoot. You know where you're supposed to focus on. Assuming that's good. Now, how do you work on your mental game? Okay, you're trying. You're trying hard enough. 9 shots, 10 shots. You have to figure out what is going wrong. Is there self-doubt? Are there too many thoughts in your head? Are you thinking constantly, will I score? Will I score? Is someone watching me? Are we going to win? Are we going to lose? What's going to happen in the next match? Our lead points in our time. If you're constantly thinking about these things, 10 shots have gone wrong. 11th shot is not going to go right either. So you have to analyze where the problem is. Is it because you're too anxious? Is it because there are too many negative thoughts? Is it because you're too low? You're too discouraged? What's going on? Once you identify what your thought is, what your cognitive thought is and what your emotion is, then you can attempt to change it. And then try to change that self-talk. And this is assuming your physical and technical skills are in place. Yes. So then go into your self-talk, your thoughts, and tell yourself that don't think about the past, focus in the present. I'm going to get the next one in and try to block out all these negative thoughts. And how do you block it out? That's a part of mental training that we work on throughout those weeks to be able to be do your best in the game. Yeah.
So that's been amazing. 2 hours of very informative information everyone's been getting on the sports psychology. Any final words from both of you? Over to you, Amrita, first.
Okay, so, you know, I'm so happy that, okay, Siddesh Palve is just raising his hand. Do we have time? Can we?
Okay, let's take one question.
Yeah,
One last question from Siddesh.
Just unmute yourself.
Siddesh, Nara.
I'll unmute. Yes.
If you can just unmute him.
Yes. Siddesh, yeah. Wait, I'm unmuting you. No, unmute yourself. Try it from your end. Yes, tell me.
Ma'am, I am straight badminton player.
Okay.
So every time I go with my coach for a tournament, and if coach is not having time, so I go with my parents, but the feeling is different at that time. So at that time, means we can say strategies we don't, means what we can say.
Okay.
Feeling is with the coach and with the parents.
Okay.
Who is it better with, Siddesh?
Who is it better with? Coach अच्छे लगते हैं साथ में हैं तब के parents.
Coach.
Okay. So I've been working in badminton a lot, so I can understand what he's trying to say. So when you have your coach around and he sits for your match, and you kind of have him as a support system to keep you giving inputs. Yeah. Now what has happened is, Siddesh, you have developed a dependency on your coach. Yes. So you are a good player, I'm assuming. But, you know, when you start depending on your strategic decisions more on your coach, you are trusting yourself less. That is what is affecting you when your parents are with you. Since you're not able to trust your own self, because you feel coach batate aur main khelta hu. Aap coach nahi hai to kaun batayega? Yeah. So basically, beta, whoever tells you anything, what you see, hear, you know, use your senses, this information goes to your brain and the brain commands the body to execute. So execute aap kar rahe ho aur command brain se hi aa raha hai, aap hi ke. So you, if I want a horse to drink water, I can get the horse to the water, but the water has to be drunk by the horse. Likewise, hum kitna bhi aapko help kare, it is you who are playing. So it is about improving your self-confidence, trust on yourself that it is you who are playing and winning and losing. It is not the coach whose only instructions are making that difference. The day you are able to believe in your own game, your own strategies, that is when, whether it is coach or whether it is parents, that will not affect you. Again, my session was about focus. What do you focus on? You are focusing on factor beyond control. Whether your coach can be with you or not is factor beyond your control. Your parents aayenge kya bolenge factor beyond your control. Lekin aap kya sochoge factor within your control. So focus on factor within your control. Help yourself develop the trust of whatever you're playing. You have over years developed your strategic intelligence to know when to play what. Even if you make a mistake or lose a match, it's not the end of the day. You learn out of your failures. Once you start becoming independent in your thought process, in your decision making, that's what is going to make you a better player. Yeah. So I hope I could give your answer. I think Unnu can also add up to it. She will also have something to say about that aspect, because I used to be very affected by my coach not being there in swimming.
I think you said it perfectly. Like, I have a personal example myself. I used to play gymnastics earlier, and sometimes our coach was very busy. So we have a vaulting horse, we run and we jump over it. So I would always wait, you know, like the judges are waiting, but if my coach comes, then I'll do my turn. But sometimes he's busy, he can't come, so I would always wait. And that point you realize that, you know, he can't be there all the time. So like ma'am correctly said, it's in your hands, it's in your game. So you focus on what you can control.
Kunni, one last question to you from one of the participants today is, how do you deal with players who have very big egos?
Okay. How do you deal with players who have very big egos?
The question has come from Anushree Patil.
As a player or as a coach?
Yeah, yeah. She says, I have a question, what to do with teammates who have a lot of ego. I mean, how to deal with them?
Okay. So you have to understand and accept that there are going to be all types of players on the field. You can't control who's there and who's not there. You have to play your game and make sure you're giving your best. There are some things you can control, some things you can't control. Exactly like ma'am said, you can't control other people's game. You can't control what they're thinking or what they're saying. You give your best. And when it comes to teaching those players how to get their ego in control, that's going to be the coach's job or psychologist's job. Don't make that your responsibility. You focus on your game.
Yeah. Okay, with that, we are going to get into some closing remarks, both from Amrita and from Kunni. You know, we have just actually touched upon the surface. There are 1 million more questions which we can all ask to find out how psychology affects a sport and an individual player. But we are going to be having many, many more individual sessions where we will actually, you know, specialize on individual sessions. But let's start off right now with the closing remarks from both our panelists.
Okay, so thank you so much, Anjali ma'am. It was a pleasure being around for this session. Football is not a game where I've been associated much, but as I say that even if it's a sport which is played as a team, there are these individuals who bring in their own personalities. Yeah, so I say that mind is playing an important role, and it is good to see that players, coaches, parents are able to understand the role of mind. It's just that mental training can get miracles if we use what has been told by us. So making sports psychology a part of your training system, having sports psychologist as a part of the team, and working together over developing mental skills rather than coming to us for a symptomatic reason, developing a foundation. जैसे हम प्रीहैब करते हैं, रिहैब नहीं होना चाहिए, इंजरी नहीं होना चाहिए, इसके लिए प्रीहैब करते हैं, वैसे ही फाउंडेशन स्किल्स ऑफ मेंटल ट्रेनिंग कैन बी टॉट टू एवरीवन सो दैट दे बिकम मेंटली टफ प्लेयर्स एंड देन व्हेन दे हैव स्पेसिफिक कंसर्न्स इंडिविजुअल सेशंस कैन हैपन. So I encourage all coaches, players, parents to look into mental training as a part of their overall training process. So this was just a start, like Anjali ma'am said, and I'm so happy with Kunni. I have been able to spread some bit of knowledge that we have on this topic. Thank you so much.
Rashmi, any closing remarks?
Yes, just wanted to thank you guys, Nirvansa and you, for hosting us and having this session on sports psychology, which is a super important topic on how we should train our mental game. I'm really excited to be part of this field, and I hope to work personally with everybody who's been as part of this webinar and Boost Women's Football. So thank you again for having us.
So I would like to thank you on behalf of all the listeners and on behalf of PIFA Foundation and my sponsors, Hefele and SPEC. I would also like to thank Nirvan and Neil, who are very, very important part of helping me set up this entire webinar. And once again, thank you for everyone for joining in. Tomorrow, we are going to be having a session on the business of football. A very important session, especially all those of you who are looking at setting up women's teams on their own or already have a women's team and want to know how to monetize it, how to take it to the next level. Please do attend tomorrow, 4 p.m. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Kunashni. Thank you, Amrita.
Thank you.